Welcome to the work of Byron Katie. Our toll-free number is 877-584-3967 or 310-760-9000.
Welcome here. Welcome. The work is simple. It's for children. It can't be heard with the mind, really. So just take a bath today. The work is simply four questions and a turnaround. No more, no less. You'll hear some talk here that means nothing. To go in and know for yourself, that's inquiry. Freedom, in my experience. Those of you new to the work, if you hear something that sounds cold, uncaring, unloving, unkind, I invite you just to be gentle with it, breathe through it, feel what arises in you around that. And if you think it would serve you, just hang in, and you may come to experience something quite the opposite of cold or uncaring. So invitation to go wherever it is you go mentally. So the work is judge your neighbor, since that's what I did best. I had to begin there. Judge your neighbor, write it down, ask four questions, turn it around. And I invite you as an audience to join the one in the chair, and she'll read what she has written down. And I invite you to get emotionally as close as you can get and to see if you have ever experienced the thing that you may be hearing here.
Hi.
Hi. So let's do the work.
Okay. I'm confused by relationships because although I like the idea of being in love, I also like my freedom, and I don't like hurting other people, nor do I like being judged by them.
So we're not supposed to judge you.
Right.
Okay. Is that true? What's the reality of it?
People do judge.
That's our job. That's our job. I like to say that's what we do best. So what happens inside of you when you attach to this concept that you don't want us to judge you, and we're judging you?
Then I feel bad.
And how do you treat us?
I usually shut you out.
And how does that feel inside of you?
Doesn't feel good at all.
Yeah. Can you see a reason to drop the story? We're not supposed to judge. I'm not asking you to drop it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, seems.
Can like you see a reason to keep the story that is not frustrating or isolating?
Do I see a reason for keeping the story?
We're not supposed to judge. It's centuries old.
It's centuries old.
Mm-hmm. People are not supposed to judge. That's insane. It's a flat out lie.
I have a big thing on that.
Yeah, you're judging that we shouldn't judge.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Who would you be without the story?
Free.
One of the things I'm clear about is I'm here for your projection. That's my only job. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
And what could you say about me that wouldn't be true? What do people judge you that's so uncomfortable? What's an example of what we would judge you?
A lot of different things.
What's the worst thing we have ever judged you for? The thing that hurt the most?
That I don't care about them.
Yeah, so go to that place. Who was it that said that? I don't mean their name.
Right. People have said it, you know, my family or...
That you don't care?
Right.
Okay, and can you name a family member, brother, sister?
My father, my brother.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So, you know the times that they're not, that you're not thinking of them?
Uh-huh.
Okay, do you care?
No.
Then they were right. So you may want to let him know that. You know, when you said I didn't care, you were right. I stopped judging you long enough to look at me, and I found it.
I know, I felt so hurt by that.
So what other thing was painful? Another painful judgment that someone made about you. You see how this is the end of war? Someone says, you don't care. Well, I don't have to defend it. I can go inside and think, well, do I? Do I care at all?
Yeah.
Oh, really? Have you inquired?
Pardon?
Have you inquired? Tell me a time you've cared about your father. What does that look like?
It's a feeling about who he is and what his life is.
And that's caring?
That's my interpretation of it.
Good.
And maybe it's, I don't know, maybe it's a selfish thing because it's something that
Well, he said you don't care. What was he speaking of?
He was speaking about me doing what I wanted to do, which was sort of leave.
And he wanted you to stay.
Right.
And you didn't care.
Right, but I did care.
You left.
Right.
And I hear it. Mm-hmm. Okay, sweetheart, let's look at the next one.
Two. How do you want them to change? I want him to stay in my life, but I don't want him to smother me.
Have you asked?
Have I asked?
I would prefer you don't smother me?
No.
Might want to try that.
Right, that feels like what's needed and wanted.
Good. You might let him know specifically also what that is.
I'm starting to see that.
So turn it around, that sentence. I want him to stop smothering me. Turn it around.
I want me to stop smothering me?
Yes. By thinking he should be a psychic and know to stop that, and you haven't asked. You smother yourself with that. Like he should know, he should understand, it should be obvious to him. Then we become hostile when they're not psychic.
Exactly.
Let's look at the next.
Okay. What is it that they should or shouldn't be, think, or feel? He shouldn't expect me not to be with other people.
Is that true? What's the reality of it?
The reality is he does.
So, how do we know he should expect you not to be with other people? He expects you not to be with other people.
Right.
That's it. The piano sits there, the candle burns, and he expects you not to be with other people. What is his? It's his job, it's what he does.
That's true. Uh-huh.
How do you treat him when you hold the belief that he's not supposed to do his job?
I shut down.
How does that feel inside of you?
It doesn't feel good.
Can you see a reason to drop the story?
Yeah, but it feels like I don't understand it.
You're not supposed to. That's his job. You want to be with people. He doesn't want you to be with people. You both have your concepts.
Right.
Yeah, they're equal. My husband says, I don't want you to be with people. I say, I understand it. And I'm going to be with people now.
Right.
But I've met him with some understanding. His is equal to mine.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to be with people now. But if I need something from him, then that's another story. If I want his approval, I'm in deep doo-doo. So I turn it around, I want my approval. And if I sell out for approval, then it doesn't feel like a resonance inside of me. No center, no peace.
Right.
So there's a thing I call the whole truth and nothing but the truth. It's, I need to be with other people now. That's just part of it. The rest of it is, I love you.
Mm-hmm.
I love you, and I'm going to be with other people now. I worked with some young men in a prison last week, and they were gang members, and they get out of prison, and then they come back, and they get out, and they come back. It's a way of life. It's, and we practice just that, and it was amazing to watch. There was much happiness in that room. They were just clear about what they wanted. No decision to make. Let's look at the next one.
Number four, do you need anything from them? I need him to understand that I love him.
He needs to understand that you love him. Is that true? Whose business is it what you understand?
Mine.
Whose business is it what he understands?
His.
How do you treat him when you hold the belief he should understand?
I stand in judgment.
Yes, you meet him with no understanding. So you're the teacher of no understanding.
So it is.
That is the simplest thing.
Right.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, can you see reason to drop the story? You should understand.
Yes, and then I see myself as being very aloof.
Well, how do you treat him when he doesn't understand? Very aloof.
Well, more intense than aloof.
So can you see a reason to drop the story? Mm-hmm. Can you see a reason to keep the story that is not frustrating? He should understand. Can you see a reason to keep it, that it's not frustrating?
Well, yeah, it puts me in a particular position.
A reason to keep the story that is not frustrating or stressful?
No, it is stressful, yes.
Mm-hmm. Who would you be without the story?
I would just be.
Understanding. The highest living understanding one. I love sharing. If I had a prayer, it would be this: God, spare me from the desire of wanting love, understanding, or approval. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
I treat my husband like not my nature when I am seeking approval or love, and the same with my children or understanding. It's unkind to me, and when I'm unkind to them, it is not kind to me. Mm-hmm. I would rather be free.
Yeah.
So let's turn that one around.
I need to understand that I love myself.
Mm-hmm. And there's another one.
I need to understand that I approve of myself.
What does it say? How did you write it?
I wrote it, I need him to understand that I love him, and I need him to understand, to realize that other relationships are important.
So turn it around.
I need to understand that
I love him.
Love him.
Yeah, just understand it. Mm. He's not supposed to understand it ever.
So I need to understand.
Your love is your business.
Right.
What does that have to do with him? Mm. I love my husband. It has nothing to do with him. He loves me, and that's not personal. He tells the story of I am this, I am that. He falls in love with his story. What do I have to do with it?
Right. Gotcha.
So I say here. I'm here for his perception. I feel like I had a choice. I'm his story, no more, no less. He's not ever met me. No one's ever met anyone.
Right, just a reflection. Yeah.
Katie?
Yes, honey.
Is it the same? You said he tells a story about you and he falls in love with the story. Is it the same for us? So if you have a story about yourself and it's just a story that you're either in love with or in hate with or whatever?
Same. You are your story. Who would you be without your story?
Wow.
Without your story, do you exist? I. I'm tall. I'm short. I'm male. I'm female. I. Who would you be without your story?
Just the thing that, like a space.
And is that true? Defining God again.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
Mm. Too small. Limiting. Any questions, thoughts?
You were talking about the not needing other people. I hear that and I can recognize that that is something I want to step into, but I...
You need people when they're there. How do I know I don't need people? They're not there. How do I know I need them? They're there. I don't call the shots on this deal. It's better if I don't. It's full. It's everything.
But I go into a lot of pain around needing.
You need people. What for?
To try to fill whatever that hunger is.
And people feel that hunger. Is it true? I mean, you've needed them all your life, and there's still hunger.
No.
So how many people does it take? And those of you new to the work, I'm not saying that you don't need people. That's not what this is about. This is about inquiry. Just to go in and experience.
It feels
meet
really,
yourself.
It feels really helpless. It feels really like reaching out for it and knowing that that's not what it is. And, okay, about reaching out for it and knowing that it's not what it is and that's not what I really need or I'm hungry for or whatever, and still not being able to stop from reaching out for it.
Well, sweetheart, you know, maybe you're not the one reaching out for it. You know, what I say is just judge your neighbor, write it down, ask four questions, turn it around. You have no goal. No goal. Other than the love of truth.
I have a hard time dropping the goal. I'm learning.
What goal?
Well, for I started doing the work, a lot of it was to get rid of the beliefs. And I'm starting to hit that, no, that doesn't work. And then to move out of the pain. And then that isn't working as much anymore either.
Don't you love it? Look forward to it.
Yeah. It's like...
I tell you what I told my son. You can't have anything. There isn't anything. There's a story. Investigate or not. So, sweetheart, let's look at the next.
What do you think of him? He's sometimes too needy.
Is that true?
Yes.
It is. What's an example of that?
Just seems like... It feels like he needs my attention or my every moment of the day.
So he needs your attention. What does that have to do with you? He just needs your attention. That's his story. So where do you come in?
Giving it to him or not giving it to him.
Yeah. So what is the truth of it? In the moment, that's all you need to know.
That I can give it or not give it.
Yeah. I love you, sweetheart. I want to give you all my attention, and I'm not able to now. I'm walking out the door. Mm-hmm. And then what's the worst that could happen? What would he say?
You're not there for me, or...
Well, he's right. You're walking out the door. You say, sweetheart, you're right. And I need to leave now. And then what's the worst that could happen?
He could just be more... just tends to be more demanding, you know. Than, oh, but I've got to talk to you now.
I hear you need to talk to me now, and I'm leaving. I love you need to talk to me. We can talk when I return, when I come back. Mm-hmm. I want to talk to you too. And I'm leaving now. We're not limited.
The truth set me free. Or I don't want to sometimes. I just don't want to.
It's because you're needy. You need him. You need him for approval. Mm-hmm. So who's needy?
I am.
You want to leave, you want to be with people, and you stay there because you're needy. And you call it him.
Mm.
So next time, just say, I'm going to pretend that you're making me stay. And the truth is, I'm needy. I need your approval. So I'll stay. If you give me your approval, let's do a straight-up deal here. If we're going to barter, let's get the marbles on the table. I'm needy. That's it. I'm not staying because I love you. I'm staying because I'm needy. I need your approval.
Great. I once was with him, where I surrendered my power and my identity
for approval. And did it work?
No, I hated it.
Well, yeah,
I left.
Yeah. So, sweetheart, I'm willing to be in that position again. Like, I don't want to be in that position again.
I'm willing to be in that position again?
Yeah, you may as well, because you could mentally experience that again. It hurts. And that pain is the reminder that you may want to investigate, that you're insane in the moment. You're saying there's something less than... You're saying reality is supposed to be different. So I look forward to...
I look forward to surrendering my power.
Oh, falling into that thing again. Yeah, surrendering my power.
Because it kind of seems like that's what's happening again,
yeah.
You know, little by little.
Yeah. Yeah, as you become needier.
Yes, it is, I said.
Yeah. This is good news. Yeah. If you think the work would serve you, welcome to the work. So let's get some feedback. It's like really clean work. You know, we have no life when we're seeking approval, love, or understanding. No life. Other than that. Any other thoughts, questions? Yes, sweetheart. Up here in front? Yeah.
So are you saying that when someone presents me with a judgment and I don't like it, it's because it's true?
Absolutely. In my experience, yes.
And there's no judgment anyone can say about anyone else that isn't true?
That's my experience. What could my husband say to me, or my children, what could they say to me that I couldn't find? They tell me I'm a terrible mother and wife. You know, I go in, I go deep, about 3 seconds, I've got it.
And then that it hurts less if I can see how it's true?
The truth sets me free. It's like having a wonderful gift every moment. It's like having Christmas or the Easter Bunny come every moment, you know? It's like I'm discovering, it's self-awareness. I've been husband-realized for years. Now I'm self-realized. Yeah. And, you know, I got a direct route one day. God is everything, God is love. God is everything, God is good. I got that. So if my husband says you're a terrible wife, that's God. Can I just go in and find it? Yes. He says I'm a wonderful wife. Can I go in and find that? Yes. This is about self-realization, not about right or wrong. It's about freedom. He says I'm wrong. Well, I can find that. He says I'm right. I can find that. So what's the worst thing anyone ever accused you of?
Being stuck up.
Can you find it?
No. I was thinking
how did
that.
You
I don't
treat
even know what it means, really.
Yeah. So how did you treat the person that brought this to your attention?
I started avoiding some.
That could be it. Stuck up. Isn't that someone that avoids?
Yeah, I guess it is.
If that person is still in your life or you cross their path again, you might say, you know, I stopped looking at you long enough to look at me. And I found out that you were right. And thank you for that. Self-love. Self-love. I say to the other what I need to hear again. There's a wonderful thing about that. A lot of freedom in it.
Thank you.
I like to find people who judge me to see if there's anything left. What is it that I harbor that would be that one little thing that it's so fine to realize? My husband and my children, my friends, they tell me, oh, just wonderful things. You see, but give me an enemy. They're really clear about what's left.
Yeah. What about when I get really upset when someone makes a judgment that I don't agree with about someone else?
What's an example?
Oh, well, let's say I were to get into a Bill Clinton argument, for example, on either side, and I get then really upset about the other person expressing the opposite point of view.
And what is a point of view that you don't agree with? What's an example of what someone says that you do not agree with?
That his private life means he shouldn't be president.
So your opinion is his private life means it is okay to be president?
Yes.
Okay. So you have yours, they have theirs. What's the difference?
I don't know. I just get upset. That's why. I don't know what the difference is.
Well, they're attached to one, you're attached to the other. What's the difference?
Well, I guess
they're disagreeing with you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when someone doesn't meet your belief system, it's threatened.
Yeah.
Okay. So what is it in your private life that is not okay with you that would keep you from running from public office?
Probably a lot of things.
There you have it.
I won't be running for president anytime soon.
And can you really know that that's true?
No.
So what are you running for when you're trying to reform the other person?
I guess I'm running.
You're campaigning.
Most right. Most right.
What for?
I don't know.
It's like you steal the attempt to change or alter their thinking. And that's the opposite of unconditional love. You live yours, and if it's attractive enough, we shift over. So when someone tells me something about Bill Clinton that I don't agree with, I'm a listener. And if there is some kind of Velcro there inside of me, I get to see what it is I'm hiding if I ran for public office. It's a good reason to run for public office. What are your thoughts?
I was just thinking how often I do try to convince people even if I don't actually say it to them all the time, I'm still thinking of ways to convince them.
Yeah. You're thinking or saying everything you need to hear, not us. Yeah. They should change their mind. I should change my mind. They should hear what I'm saying. I should hear what I'm saying. I should hear what they're saying. These turnarounds are very powerful for some of us. Welcome to the work.
Thank you.
Welcome. Any other thoughts, questions? Yes, sweetheart.
A lot of what you've been saying recently has been to only heal oneself, which would also say to let all the problems that the world has, say with the environment, say with different forms of pollution.
Yes.
You know, just to totally drop it and heal oneself. And as oneself is healed, I realize that the experience in one's own life also changes.
Yes, before I clean up the earth's environment, let me clean up my own environment. And the environment, all the trash and the pollution in my thinking, let me meet that with some understanding. And as I get clear about that, I notice that the earth cleans up at the same proportion. Same proportion. In like.
Sounds like a one-to-one relationship.
Yes, on the earth. It's a one-to-one relationship.
And that also we're only ever meeting ourselves.
Yes. No one else to meet. Home. Center. Unmoving. I had an experience several years ago, and I saw that nothing was true, and I'd never heard of such a concept. It was obvious. Nothing was true. And all of the concepts, thoughts that had ever been done, ever appeared, continued to appear now. I met each one of them. It was like a squirrel cage. They came so fast, and people were calling me names I'd never heard before, like awake. Like, duh, well, yeah, I'm out of bed. But my love of what is, I only have an internal life. And you are my internal life. That's what I was left with. Nothing here, quiet, mindless, I don't think so. Then there was you. Not done till it's done. Self-love. I come back for you, you're me. No mountaintops, not until you're on a mountaintop. You are my internal, one-to-one. Self, meeting self. Any other thoughts, questions?
I'm curious about children and whether they have the perspective to utilize the work. I mean, I don't know what the question is really, other than
do children understand this work?
Yes, or is that just innate?
children absolutely understand this work. Children are everyone in this room. There are only concepts. There are no adults. There are no children. Concepts are ageless, and that's all that exists. And if you investigate, you don't even have those. So children, here's what children say. My father should understand me. My friend should listen to me. I want you to love me. Not one thing that we've heard this evening is new. Children, by the time they're 4 or 5, have every concept that has been spoken in this room. There are no new concepts.
So how do adults get to this place where they get so confused? I mean, truly, it's
children are just as confused, in my experience.
Then why do adults get so messed up?
So turn it around and ask you.
Because I had no perspective as a youth, and it evolved.
Sweetheart, your mother said, okay, well, who told you that it was a... Who told you that there was a sky? Do you remember who told you that?
I never asked. I recognized this. I don't remember. No. I accepted that it was there.
You accepted it?
Yes.
Okay. So that's why. You didn't ask. You didn't go inside. It's a sky. Like mommy will say, for example, or the radio or television says, it's a sky. Oh, okay. He didn't ask you. So that's what we're doing this evening. Some of us are going inside and inquiring within ourselves and not waiting for the answers from me or anyone else. So my mother says it's a sky, and I go, whoa. Not to me. Where did that come from? Outer space? No. Just the word. So children are the same. One of my grandsons fell down, and he was 3, and he scraped his knee open, and there was some blood, no big deal. And he began to cry, and he looked up at me, and I said, sweetheart, are you remembering when that hurt? Are you remember when you fell down and that hurt? And he was gone. That was it. Because he was in the past. The moment is gone. It's a remembering. I ask him. You're 3. I do children's workshops in Europe. And I've done some here also. There was a little boy that hated school. It's like the worst thing that could happen to him. He was, in his opinion, overweight. People teased him. And we did the work one evening, and he emailed me to let me know that that was, like, he loves school, it's gone. And I think he was 8 or 9, 7, 8, I don't know. And then this year, and he was so... He so didn't want to be seen. And this year when I went to Amsterdam, he emailed me he told the hostess where I was staying that he wanted to be the interpreter for the children's workshop. And so when I stepped into that space, it was the adult workshop
And he was there, and I asked him if he would be the interpreter for the adult workshop. And there were many people there. It was a very large room at the Plato School, School of Theology. And he stood up, and he had his mouth full of wires and all kinds of stuff on his teeth. And he stood up in front of everyone, and he was just ripping that stuff out, just handing it to anyone. And he interpreted. He translated English into Dutch. It's ageless. Four questions. Turn it around. If children can talk, they can understand it. But you only give children what you need to hear. There are no children to heal. There are no children that need understanding. There is mere image of your thinking, that's all. So good you would use them to get free. They don't mind, they are you. If I think someone needs the work, I need the work. That's why the work was by invitation only. Welcome, welcome. Wow. So, sweetheart, just deep breath and begin.
Do you want me to read the whole thing?
I do.
Okay. Annie is fake. She is rude. She is uncaring, and she is disconnected. I want Annie to quit feeling sorry for herself. I want Annie to be confident, and I want her to not be so jealous. And I want her to have appreciation. Annie shouldn't treat me like dirt. Annie shouldn't treat me like a slave. I need Annie to tell me I'm a good dancer, and I need Annie to approve of me. Yeah. Annie is unbelievably gorgeous. She's a beautiful dancer, and she's a bitch. And I don't ever want to do a favor for her again, and I refuse to ever hang a trapeze for her again.
Yeah. Painful stuff, huh, babe?
I'm so pissed.
Yeah. So let's take a look at it. Start at the top again. If you have someone like this in your life or ever have, you know, you may want to follow the investigation.
She's my dance teacher, and I feel like that if I don't get her approval, I'll never be able to do what my passion is without her telling me that I'm good enough.
So you would never be able to realize your dream without her approval. Can you really know that that's true?
It's just that I've given it so much meaning.
I understand. And can you really know that that's true? That without her approval, you cannot meet your dream?
No.
And how do you treat her when you hold the belief that she is your ticket?
Like she's God. Like I'm less than and she's more than.
And how do you treat her? How do you do that specifically? What do you say? What do you do to get her approval?
Oh, it's ugly.
Yeah.
Ugly. Because then I'll do anything for her.
Yeah.
And then I feel like shit about myself.
Yeah. What does it look like, what you say and do, to get her approval? I realize it's ugly, and what does it look like, specifically? Are you going in? How do you live to get approval?
I basically just follow her around, and since I'm tall, I can reach the ropes to take the trapezes down, and I'll do errands for her, and...
So you're a slave for approval?
Mm-hmm.
Can you see a reason to drop the story that you need her approval to meet your dream? I'm not asking you to drop it.
Lots of reasons.
Can you see one good reason to keep the story that is not painful? I need her approval to meet my dream. Who would you be without this story, hanging out with her? Who would you be
without? I could just be there with her and know that I don't need anything from her. I could, God, it would be so awesome. It would be so freeing.
That's who and what you are without the story that you need her approval. That's how I live.
I can, it shows.
It's much more difficult to seek approval. It's deadly. It kills. You lose yourself in it, and you never get it. So I need her approval to realize my dream, turn it around?
I need my approval.
And you're not getting it, being a slave. And you may come to see that she has never required any of this. That she didn't even ask. Find it. Wonderful fun hanging out with people after we do this work. So read the first one.
I hate Annie because she's fake, rude, uncaring, and disconnected.
Turn it around.
I hate Kristen because she's...
I hate me. Let's
I
get
hate
personal.
Me. I hate me. Because I'm fake, rude, uncaring, and disconnected.
Especially around her. Totally fake, totally rude, totally lost, totally confused. Very painful, Angel. It's a trapeze act. Let's look at the next.
I want Annie to quit feeling sorry for herself.
Hopeless. Turn it around.
I want me to quit feeling sorry for myself. Totally.
That's not her job, it's yours. She has no interest, you do.
I want... Who said that?
Someone who needs to do that turnaround. No.
Okay.
So what do you see, Marissa?
I need me to stop feeling sorry for
her.
Yeah.
Oh. The next one, I want Annie to be confident. And I want me to be confident.
Isn't that truer?
Oh, it's so true.
She needs more confidence.
It's bullshit.
Bullshit. Like, thank
yeah.
you.
Thick.
And how do you treat her when you attach to the belief she needs to be more confident?
I can feel superior. And there's something about me that likes to feel that way.
Is that true?
No.
No.
Oh, God. Oh. I don't... I want appreciation from Annie. Is it true? I missed the joke.
No, honey, you're just, you know, you're just getting this really fast.
It's because my, yeah, well, anyway. I want, the turnaround of that would be I want to, me to approve of and appreciate myself.
You want appreciation from her. I like that. Is it true? Is that what you really want?
Yeah.
And what do you do to get it?
Bad things that don't make me feel good. Which I don't like.
And do you ever get it?
No.
Yeah. So maybe you don't want it anymore. Pretty hopeless.
Mm-hmm.
Whose business is it who you appreciate or what?
Mine.
Has anyone ever changed your mind about that and said, you see that? Appreciate it. Can anyone make you do that?
No.
So whose business is her appreciation?
Hers.
So you keep putting things in front of her to look good.
God.
And turn it around again.
I need her appreciation.
I need my appreciation.
Yes. You're the one.
Mm-hmm.
I love that part. You never have to wait for anyone else.
You just are.
Yeah.
Hot dog, huh? Annie, shouldn't treat me like dirt.
Is that true?
She doesn't have the power to treat me like dirt. So I guess it's not.
She just does what she does.
She just is what she is.
And is it true she treats you like dirt? Isn't it truer she just doesn't give you approval or appreciation when you want it? So maybe she's just living her life. Maybe she's just a person who cannot be manipulated.
Amy shouldn't treat me like dirt. I guess I just get to feel like the victim.
Well, yes, you are. Look what you do for approval.
And then that turns into the poor me, sorry for myself cycle.
Yeah, you're treating you like dirt.
I don't want me to treat me like dirt.
Yes.
Annie shouldn't treat me like a slave.
She doesn't. Turn it around.
Kristen, I shouldn't treat myself like a slave.
And there's another turnaround.
I shouldn't treat Annie like a slave. Oh, my God. I need Annie to tell me I'm a good dancer.
Is that true?
No.
Turn it around.
I need me to tell me I'm a good dancer and appreciate me.
Are you a good dancer?
Very. Yeah. Thank you.
That's very sweet.
I need Annie to approve of me.
Hopeless.
Yeah.
Turn it around.
I need me to approve of me.
Yeah. And again.
I don't want to approve of her. Honestly.
Well, you have everything in common.
I'm her. Isn't that... That's so scary. That I'm her when I say that I don't want to approve of her. And so if I can drop that anger at her, then maybe one day I can honestly feel like...
What I say is just stay in the work. Use her to set yourself free. Judge your neighbor. Write it down. Ask more questions. Turn it around.
I judge her constantly. Where's Mom? She's gone. Don't I judge her quite well?
Are you looking for your mother's approval?
There you go. Definitely.
Carolyn, don't you love it?
My next page will be on you then, Mom. Annie is an unbelievably gorgeous dancer.
Turn it around.
Kristen, I am an unbelievably gorgeous dancer.
Feel it. Don't you know it?
It's hard to feel.
It's rare to find someone so comfortable in their body.
Really?
Well, that's just silly me. But it just, your limbs are so free and beautiful and sweet, honey. And if you dance the way you know, it has nothing to do with your inside, only you can know that. But if you dance the way you move here, it's just very lovely from here, that's what I can say. It doesn't appear to be pretentious, or it's just a fluid, sweet, like a child. It's very sweet.
I'm a bitch.
And the moment I see her as a bitch, feel it. Like a bitch.
It feels bad and ugly and gross.
So she's a bitch, is it true?
No.
The next one.
I don't ever want to do a favor for her again.
I'm willing.
I'm excited. I can't wait to go home and just do all the favors she wants.
Yes, honey.
And I can't wait to go and swing on trapezes with her.
Yeah. Yes, sweetheart.
Thank you so much.
Welcome. Sweetheart, welcome to the work.
Thank you.
So let's hear what appears now.
I don't like commitment because it scares me and confuses me.
Yes.
I'm angry at my mom for always having judgmental opinions of the men I date.
Yes.
I don't like the men that are attracted to me because they are usually in debt or unestablished financially, or have low self-esteem.
Yes, I'm appreciating your integrity.
Thank you. I am confused.
Have you noticed?
I am confused by decisions because they make me doubt myself. I want God to send me my Prince Charming.
Yes, right away.
You bet. I want God to make it easy for me to commit to a partnership.
Yes.
I want my partner to be financially stable.
Yes.
I want my mom to stop controlling me. I want decisions to be easy. I want my intuition to be strong.
Yes.
This is funny. When I wrote this, I said, I want my partner to be established in the work.
Mm.
And I meant the world.
Yes.
But I meant the work.
Yeah.
My family should approve of the man I marry.
Yes.
I need my partner to be strong, stable, secure, funny, perfect.
Mm-hmm.
I need choices and commitment to come naturally. I need choices and commitment to come naturally. That's a big one. Commitment makes me nervous. It is a projection into the future.
Mm-hmm.
My mom is hard on men, controlling, protective, idealistic, judgmental, has an agenda, wants the best for me, doubts my choices, believes in me, and loves me the best she knows how. I don't ever want to be in love with a man that is in debt again.
Mm-hmm.
I don't ever want to care what others think about my choice, my choices. I don't ever want to feel confused again. I don't ever want to fall deeply in love and then change my mind again.
Mm.
Because it hurts.
Yes. Okay, is this familiar? Okay, sweetheart. So let's start at the top.
I don't like commitment because it scares me and confuses me.
Is that true?
In my experience, I felt scared by commitment.
The idea of commitment. And has commitment ever scared you?
No.
No. Once you commit it, it's over.
Yeah.
No pain.
True.
The only pain is confusion. Confusion is wanting two things at once.
Or more than two things at once.
Yeah. So, commitment, read it again.
I don't like commitment because it scares me and confuses me.
Is it true?
No.
No. So, put the word thinking on it, and where you have the word commitment, and turn it around and see if that's as true or truer.
I don't like my thinking because it scares me and confuses me.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
I wanted to do this with you because I've been doing the work for about 5 months on my own and with friends, and definitely seeing some changes.
Yeah.
But there's so many, like, little stuck places in here.
Isn't that fine? Look forward to it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm angry at my mom for always having judgmental opinions of the men I date.
Is that true?
What is what true?
That
I'm angry at her?
At your mother because she judges your...
Right now, no.
Yeah. Isn't that fine?
Actually, not much of this is true right now.
Or any of it?
Probably none of it.
Yes. Isn't that fine? The moment is always that way.
Mm-hmm.
Always.
Yes.
If we stop to ask, is it really true? Well, no, not in this moment.
Mm-hmm.
So this thinking that you've identified would imply a future. Mm-hmm. And that is fearful.
Yes.
Because there is no future now. Just as lovely as this, but only always. So, what happens when you hold the belief that your mother is supposed to like your male friends, and she doesn't?
I'm constantly doubting myself and my choices.
Mm-hmm. And how do you treat your mother when she judges, and you attach to this belief that she's not supposed to?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Those of you new to the work, people are not supposed to judge. What's the reality of it, do they? That's our job. We judge. We've been guided to stop judging for generations, and it's still what we do best. I can say it's still what I did best. Interesting phraseology there. So how do you treat her when you attach to this lie? And my new friend, my new old friend, this is attachment. We don't attach to things. We're attached to this sacred concept, the one in the moment, the one that would take us apparently outside of us into that illusion.
Well, I judge her. I don't communicate or share with her. I shut down around her.
And how does that feel inside of you?
It
to
hurts.
Shut her out?
It hurts.
Yes. So can you see a reason to drop the story? And those of you new to the work, in no way does this work ever suggest that you drop a concept, that you drop the story. I just invite people, don't even go there. We have been taught to drop the mind. You know, can we just meet it with a little understanding? We may as well. Have you noticed? Here it comes. Now.
Yeah, so if it's okay for her to judge.
Yes, it's her job. It's what she does.
Mm-hmm. Very well.
Very well. She's very good at it. So can you see one good reason to remain attached to the story, I want her to stop judging? One good reason to keep the story that is not stressful.
No.
Yeah. Who would you be without the story in her presence? I want her to stop judging.
And especially I want her to stop judging negatively, you know, not approving.
Have you noticed it's hopeless? No matter how you isolate from her, move away,
mm-hmm.
No matter what internal tantrum or external tantrum we show, we exhibit,
mm-hmm.
She does it. This is what she does. So who would you be without the story?
Just me doing what I do, loving her and loving who I love.
Yes, isn't
and loving
that
myself.
Fine.
Yeah.
That's my preference.
Yeah.
Silly me. I love peace. I love love. It's my nature. It's what I am.
It feels really strong.
Yeah. And I would trade that for taking God's position on how to raise a mother. Mentally in my business, home. Mentally in my mother's business, hopeless.
Mm-hmm.
Lonely, separate. So, sweetheart, let's turn this around.
I'm angry at myself for always having judgmental opinions of the men I date.
Isn't that as true?
Very.
So you and your mother are identical.
I am. I am angry at that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, you and every human are identical.
Yeah.
We judge them and we inquire. We come to know that. Nothing new under the sun, not one new concept.
Mm-hmm.
So there's another turnaround.
I'm angry at myself for always having judgmental opinions of my mom. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And there's another one.
I'm angry at the men I date.
I'm angry at me.
I'm angry at me for always having judgmental opinions
of myself.
Ah. Oh, whoa! Ding, 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 ding. It's so good when you get it yourself. Yeah. Oh, that felt good.
There's nothing sweeter than self-realization.
Mm-hmm.
We've been mother-realized for quite a while. But to be self-realized, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Homecoming. Mm-hmm. Let's look at the next.
Let's look. I don't like the men that are attracted to me because they are usually in debt or unestablished financially.
So you don't like the men that you are that are attracted to you. Is that true?
No.
No. And if they don't have the money, they don't have the job, the security.
Right.
Okay, is it true you're not attracted to them?
No.
No. We don't really want to hear that. That could be really scary. You could marry one of them or something.
Uh-huh. Why am I attracted to...
What if you were attracted to everyone?
True. Feels like it's really easy to fall in love for me. Very easy.
It's difficult not to.
Yes.
It's a full-time job not to fall in love with the thing and the one in front of you.
Yes. And they fall in love with me. And then boundaries.
Yeah. Someone falls in love with me, I like that a lot. You know, who am I to judge their preferences? So without a story, who would you be?
I would be just in love.
Yes. And we would have nothing to do with it.
No.
This is you you're meeting. And it doesn't mean you have to marry that one or go home with that one or go to dinner. This is an internal thing.
Mm-hmm.
Someone falls in love and they say, I want to live with you forever. You can say, I understand. I love you too. And I need to leave now.
Right.
This is an internal experience. Has nothing to do with physical. And when we know that, we don't need anyone outside of us to take care of our physical. We don't even need us. We're outside of us.
Mm-hmm.
Have you always been taken care of?
Yes.
Yes. And have you ever really had anything to do with it?
No.
No, we have wonderful stories about how we do. I. We stop to inquire and we come to see that, you know, well, maybe this is beyond me. Maybe I have everything I need. So, sweetheart, let's... what happens when you hold a belief? You meet a man, you're attracted, and what happens when you hold the belief that they are supposed to have some great job or security? And they don't.
And they don't. Then I get to think, wow, there's that pattern again, and beat myself up, and...
And how does that feel?
It feels like I'm not worthy. It feels like there's something wrong with me.
And how do you treat them when you attach to this concept?
I shut down.
Mm-hmm.
Or I try to caretake.
So how does it feel inside of you when you either try to take care of someone that's perfectly capable of doing it? I mean, that includes someone with paralysis on the floor. They can take care of themselves. It's internal caring that we find. And if no one comes, it leaves us. We find it. We find it.
Mm-hmm.
So someone needs your help. Can you really know that that's true?
No.
No, they need you to care for them. Is that true?
No.
What do you get when you hold the belief? How do you treat
them when you're taking caretaking.
I get to feel better then. I get to feel I have a purpose, I'm superior, yes. or I'm in yes. control.
Yes. Boy, you'd be a trip to be around.
Wait, what?
So close your eyes. Let's take the trip. Look at you caretaking this inferior male. Look at you. Look at you in the picture.
Mm-hmm.
Bestowing your grace upon this underling. Yes? Good. Life is internal.
Yeah.
So, Angel, can you see a reason to drop the story?
Yes.
What are you experiencing?
Humility, just being this.
Yes. My thought was experiencing, it would be like all the men I have used, all the humans I have used in an attempt to gain some kind of...
I'm better than.
Yeah, or some kind of security or stability.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah. Some kind of internal strength.
Yes.
And how it doesn't ever feel that way. It doesn't ever play out
you
that way.
You are good.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I am. I realize that self.
Yes.
And if we do that with just an acquaintance, then we do it with our children and our parents and our spouses, the people we love most, because we attach to the concept and we get that experience. We inquire and something else appears to be happening. I call it freedom. Freedom from self. And I'm appreciator of self.
Mm-hmm.
It's just confused, like you would pity a child. You know, that is the self I see here. If anything. So, sweetheart, can you see a reason to drop the story that you need to caretake anyone? And I'm not asking you to drop the story.
Yeah, it feels really free.
And no accepting. One to take care of.
Yes.
No one to be.
Mm-hmm.
Just wonderful, wonderful you.
Mm-hmm.
Who would you be without this story?
Joy.
That's caretaking. Through your joy, we come to know something else. Through your caretaking, we come to know that you'll take care of us. Only that doesn't work either. So, sweetheart, let's look at the next one.
I am confused by decisions because they make me doubt myself.
Is that true?
No.
No decision has done anything but bring someone peace and clarity.
Unless I doubt my decision once I've made it.
In which case, it's not the decision that's the
but
problem.
It's been
the story running about the decision.
Right.
Yeah. And no decision is wrong.
Right.
Yeah. There's no decision that's wrong. We begin now. Now.
Mm-hmm.
You know what to do. There's a place where you always know. And you honor that or not, and you get another chance.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay if you honor it. It's okay if you don't honor it. What this work does is it brings us some clarity, and we learn to open, like woman, just open and receive that voice and honor it. You mentioned intuitiveness here. You always have it. You need more intuition. Everyone has an equal amount. There's no more, no less.
Mm-hmm.
And a story is an attempt to mute it. Doesn't work. So when it's time to make a decision, you can make it. There's no harm there. The worst that can happen is a story. You don't make it, the worst that can happen is a story. And again, you get another chance. Now, now, now. You cannot marry the wrong person. You cannot commit to the wrong thing. The worst that can happen is the story you run around it.
That is such a big one.
Yeah.
Just because there is enough. There is a belief that there's a right and a wrong.
There is a movement within that is ever present, and it's an opportunity to open up to it. It's like you reach out, or you walk, or you act. We'll say act. And then there's a thing that moves, and it's to bring it back. And to receive and honor that intuition is a great freedom. Mm-hmm. And in that space of honoring, of opening to it, of saying yes to it, the space opens again. But life is like that. I was with the sweetest man today, and very, very still. And the only thing sweeter than that is coming out. And the only thing sweeter than being out is going in. Everything is a breath. Mind is a breath. There's no decision you can make that isn't going to return again like a tide, like a wave. Just in and out. There's nothing serious ever. And if you want it all, listen. Open to it. Or not. No harm. You want more, open. Or not. Look at the next one.
I want God to send me my Prince Charming.
Hopeless. And why would God bother? You've got him here. This job, yeah. That security. This. Yeah. So God keeps sending them and you keep...
Nope, not that one. Not,
yeah, not that one, not that one. I love without a story, you... simply are just one with the one in front of you.
It's pretty funny.
A chair, a carrot, a human, a baby, a male, a female, now, now, now.
Yes, yes.
That's
yes.
Abundance. Now, now, show me what I would not marry. It's not a possibility. There's no way you can't. You already have. You are that. Merged. Not separate. Same. Any story that you would attach to would be simply the thing you use not to experience the awareness of what you are, unlimited. Life, life, life. I love life. Of course I would. It's myself. Look at the next.
I want God to make it easy for me to commit to a partnership.
Hopeless. Hopeless. Turn it around.
I want myself to make it easy for me to commit to a partnership.
Yes. And one way to do that, in my experience, is to investigate in the way that you're doing. read it again the way you wrote it.
I want God to make it easy for me to commit to a partnership.
So God should make it easy for you. That way you don't have to do it. Strike it easy for
me. Yes.
Has it happened yet?
No.
No. Have you given it your best shot? Have you prayed?
Yes.
Yeah, on your knees. Has it helped? I'm not saying don't pray. Don't even go there. You know, when you're a pinch, I don't think anyone has to tell you anyway, on your knees. You know, you tried everything else. So how does it feel when you're dictating to God? On your knees. I'm serious this time.
Hopeless.
Hopeless. So how do you live when you hold the belief that God is supposed to strike it easy for you?
I feel very much like, actually, a victim. Like,
yes.
And
God's last child at the bottom of his list.
Send me the signs and, you know, yeah. All of that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and no sign.
No.
Yeah, so that leaves you unloved. And if God doesn't love you, what does that leave you? Orphaned? Unlovable? That's where this goes.
Mm-hmm.
How does it feel to be separate from God on the bottom of his list, or at least not at the top?
Just painful. Just separate. Yeah.
Separate. Can you see a reason to drop the story?
Mm-hmm.
Can you see one good reason to keep the story that is not stressful?
No.
Who would you be without the story that God is supposed to strike you easy?
I think I would be more self-worthy, more trusting of myself, more open, more of that breath.
My thought was the end of procrastination.
Oh.
I think I'll wait for God. After all, it's his job. He'll strike me easy. You know, if it gets bad enough, just before I die, he'll strike it easy and I won't have to do it.
Good.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah, to our last gasp. Yeah. Let's look at the next. Sweetheart, the one just before that, turn it around.
I want me to make it easy for me to commit to a partnership.
Yes.
Yes. I want me to make it easy for me to commit to myself.
Yes. That's the partnership.
Yes.
The self meeting the self. That's the partnership. If I wait for God to do it, it's not so easy. It's a long wait. When I'm on my knees praying to God with all sincerity, I'm the one listening. Yes. I don't see anyone else listening. You see, I'm a lover of reality. Can I listen? And when I hear it, God. No separation. One.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's the choice. I use the word choice today. Well, that's when, if I want God to do it, I turn it around and I do it. If it was fit for him, let me wear it.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the peace of that, I may come to know something else. I may come to see that I'm not even doing that. I'm not even thinking me. Let's look at the next.
I want my partner to be financially stable.
What for?
A sense of security.
Yeah.
For fun.
Yeah. Yeah. And in my experience, there's nothing more secure and there's nothing more fun than self-realization. Isn't that why we want money? Then I'll work on this spiritual thing. Yeah. Yeah. And the beautiful thing about inquiry is you can do it from where you are. while you're making the money, while you're at home, when you're with your lover, when you're with yourself. Life is internal. It's like, oh, I love this man. Oh, I love me. When I love this man. You see, the all-inclusive. God should strike it easy for me. I should strike it easy for me. Oh, I just struck it easy for me. God. God. In, out. Let's look at the next.
I want my mom to stop controlling me.
And how do you treat her when you attach to that concept?
I put her down. I shut her out of my life.
Can you see a reason to drop the story?
Once again, it's just freedom.
It's a child's story. It's a fairy tale. It's mythology.
It's not true.
It's not true. It just never happened. Not in all of the beginning of time, the beginning of thought. This is the story. What does she say?
What does she say? You know, she's really supportive of me. She's incredibly supportive of me.
Yeah.
She says, I love you. I want what's best for you. Call me and let me know you're okay.
And what does she say about the men when she's judging them?
She doesn't say anything. She makes those looks.
She gives you the look.
She gives me the look or the hesitation or, you know, the vibe. You can feel the vibe.
You have to feel the vibe because you look at her face, you tell the story about what that means, and you feel your own story.
I feel my own doubt about
who I'm
with.
She's giving me the vibe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hope is not possibility. It's not a possibility.
So I want me to give myself the gift of just saying yes, and yes, and yes.
And no is yes.
Yes.
Someone says, do you want to go to dinner? Yes. You want to go to dinner?
No. Yes.
It's not about dinner.
Yes.
It's about, can I just own the truth now?
Mm-hmm.
Can I just speak it? Mm-hmm. And that's it. That's that intuition we were talking about. We'll call it that. It's just simply God saying you want to go to dinner. No.
Mm-hmm.
You want to go to dinner? Yeah, it's just a question.
Simple.
Just the question. Can you dare to speak the answer? And it's okay if you do or don't. Just watch. Just awareness.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, you can love everyone and go to dinner or not.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, no. That's my lover. The place where that yes or that no comes from, that's my lover. That's my partner. That's what I'm married to. Always there. And to tell you yes when my integrity is no is to divorce that partner and to grab onto you tighter because I'm homeless.
Mm-hmm.
In a hopeless state of mind. Lost. But only for 43 years.
This is fun.
Yeah. Life is inside. Yes, sweetheart. It's like being a child again. Free. Mm-hmm. Good.
I want decisions to be easy. I want my intuition to be strong.
Yeah. So decisions are easy until you, it's the story you tell around them that are not easy.
Mm-hmm.
I tell the story of jumping out of a parachute and you pull the cord. It doesn't open and you feel fear because you have the next cord to pull. So you pull that one, and it doesn't open, and that's the last cord. there's no decision to make, so you just enjoy the trip. Yes? Yes. And that's this position. I'm a lover of what is. What is? No cord to pull. It's already happening. Free fall. I don't dictate it. I love the thing in front of me, which is what we're playing with. And I love that there's something in front of me. You know, the last judgment.
It's almost a addiction to indecision that happens.
Yeah, how can you be present if you're in mind?
Yeah.
This will happen if I do, this will happen if I don't. If you inquire, can I know that? Can I really know that that's true? If you choose this man or to go to dinner with this man, you know, what's the worst that could happen? You marry this man, what's the worst that could happen?
A belief that I did the wrong thing. That's the worst that can happen. Mm. Doubt.
The worst that can happen when you marry a man is you'll have a story around the man. That's it. Whether you marry him or not, you're going to have a story around perfect stranger. We only marry men who agree with us. That way our system is safe. Our story is safe. We tell the story of it's a chair, it's a sky, it's a moon, and we don't like the neighbors. And he says, yes, 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 and yes. But then you're married a while, and your system begins to be attacked. And rather than go in and inquire, we go to war and divorce. Look at the next one. Just look at your number six.
I never want to be in love with a man that is in debt again.
Is that true?
No.
No. So I'm willing?
Oh. I think I am in love with a man who's in debt, actually. What?
I'm willing?
Oh. I'm willing to be in love with a man that is in debt.
Yes, sweetheart. Yes, and watch how your mind rips him to shreds, calls him unworthy, and terrorizes yourself with how you're going to be homeless if you go there. Okay? And that kind of fear can put you back into the work. Fear is a kiss that says, sweetheart, it's time to inquire.
Mm-hmm.
That's all. Feeling is not something to marry the right person to heal. A feeling is the gift that says it's time to inquire. That's all. Simple. So I look forward to.
I look forward to falling in love with a man who is in debt.
Yes. Very exciting.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Anyone
there's
in
one,
debt? No.
There's one. There's one.
That could be fun.
How many men here are not in debt? There's one. There's one. There's one. There's one. There's four. So see her
wow.
On the other side of this. But then you have to tell another story to keep you separate.
Yeah. And
they won't be handsome enough.
Right,
yeah,
right.
Or healthy enough.
Right.
Yeah.
Or too old.
They'll be too old.
Right.
Yeah. So, you know, a story appears, thought appears, and until we have investigated separation. So Prince Charming is every moment, without exception. Good, sweetheart.
Yeah.
I don't ever want to care what others think about my choice.
I'm willing.
My choices. I'm willing to care what other people think about my choices. I look forward to caring about what other people think about my choices.
Yes, because we're going to judge it hard.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's exciting.
Yeah. See, it's such a setup to be strong or for the buzzer to go off.
Yeah.
To make the right decision. Yeah.
Yeah, the defense buzzer. And defense, when you notice it, is a buzzer, yes, to let you know it's you're insane in the moment and it's time to investigate.
Mm-hmm.
Suffering is optional. I look forward to?
I look forward to caring what other people think about my choices.
Good. Is there another?
There's two more. I don't ever want to feel confused again.
I'm willing?
I'm willing to feel confused again and again.
Yes. Confusion is... See, we want the cord... We want the parachute not to open. We want to get this over with. Can you go there?
Yeah.
We want to get it over with. That because it is so frightening to experience confusion that anything is better than that. And we stay confused. So I am a lover of what is. If the chute opens, good. If the chute opens, doesn't. I love what is. Not because I'm a spiritual woman, but because it hurts when I argue with it. I stopped arguing. I am a lover of what is. What is, is. So I'm no longer confused. If I want someone to stop judging me, I'm quite insane. And I'm going to feel that. Because I am not loving what is. How do I know they're supposed to judge me? They're doing it. That's what is. Like a tree stands there, and we don't say, you, tree, should be the rose bush, and I'm going to dedicate my life to changing you from this tree to this bush. We don't do it. It's ridiculous because we know, like a tree is steady. It doesn't move. You see, you can talk to it all you want, like a wall. So we don't bother. We go to something that we can project what we are onto to make it real. And it's still like a tree. It's what is.
Mm-hmm.
Like the weather. So when you're a lover of what is, you're no longer confused. The season changes. You're there. The person judges rapture. And good that it wouldn't be. You will feel that, and it's an opportunity to clean up, you know, to see that for what it really is. It's an illusion.
Mm-hmm.
You're in an insane state of mind in the moment only. So fear is, it's a good thing. It's simply the voice for inquiry. So let's get some feedback. Thoughts, questions? Okay.
Thanks. I don't ever want to fall deeply in love and then change my mind again.
I'm willing.
I'm willing to fall deeply in love and then change my mind again.
Yes, yes, yes. Because changing your mind is, it's like changing your mind about I don't love is not a possibility. You can only lose the awareness of it, not the state. That's immovable. Mm-hmm. That's not up for grabs. That is not an option. You know, theory or no theory, I am that. That it in the dream, what we call love could be hatred. It doesn't matter. It's like. It's a word. Love's a word. Whatever it is, if it doesn't resonate, it's not me. It's an illusion. And that's what inquiry is for. So I'm willing.
I'm willing to fall deeply in love and then change my mind again. I look forward to falling deeply in love and then changing my mind again.
Yes. Because there's nothing you can do to fall out of love. It's what you are.
It's remembering and forgetting.
And what if you don't forget? What if you trade that state, that awareness, for the story appearing in the moment that's not real, that you're attached to it, that's like the trip out. And it's a good thing. It's okay. Just inquire and come back like the breath.
Okay. Gotcha. Gotcha.
You cannot do it wrong. No one has ever done it wrong. Thoughts, questions?
Right here. Is it Katie? The number 6 about people judging your choices, would you read that again?
I don't ever want to care what others think about my choices.
Turn it around.
I don't ever want to care what I think about my choices.
I'm willing.
And I don't ever want to care what... I'm willing.
To care
about my choices.
What I think about my choices.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Number 6s are so powerful. I watched Dorothy. She just... The woman's a number 6.
Is this Dorothy?
Yes. This is Dorothy from the Center of the Work. And when you call the Center for the Work... And Dorothy will nuke you.
Thank you.
I'll move to it.
Thank you, Joy.
Thank you very much.
Welcome, precious.
Yeah. Good to finally do it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Let's play.
Were you out there with the baby?
No, I was actually out there with my boyfriend who was screaming at me for not coming up here. He left. So I just had this like huge crisis and my heart is beating and he's completely... I'm doing exactly what he didn't want me to do. To share.
Yeah.
So I'm a little bit like,
Yeah. So what do you think? You want to wait?
No, I'm pretty raw for that. Yeah, let's. I don't want to wait.
Yeah.
Sit down. You can join me. Just sit down. This is Jonna.
Hi, Jonna.
Do you want to sit by my feet so that I can work in case I move my arms? Don't be scared, sweet. Okay, she can sit. Like, is it okay?
Yeah.
All right. Who or what don't you like, or who what irritates you? I don't like, and I'm angry, and I'm confused, and I'm saddened at racial prejudice. It's stupid.
Sweetheart, we're not supposed to be prejudiced. On what planet? Are you prejudiced about our prejudice?
Yes.
How prejudiced of you. What a bigot.
I'm a bigot against bigotry.
Yeah.
I love you. I love you too, Jenna.
Yeah. So, how does it feel inside of you when you attach to this concept that would argue with reality? We're not supposed to be prejudiced. Sweetheart, that's our job. We're prejudiced.
How does it feel?
Yeah.
Well, it's hopeless. I feel sad. I feel sad.
Yeah. That's what confusion feels like. It's sad and hopeless. That's confusion. Can you see a reason to drop the story? That's confusion. You are telling the story of something you don't believe. You know we're supposed to be prejudiced. We are. We're in your face every day. On television, on radio, in your industry, here in the room.
Yeah.
In the newspapers, we're prejudiced. You see that red spot on the carpet?
Yeah.
Okay. You see the white, where it starts the border white?
Yes.
Okay. How prejudiced. How separate. I mean, they won't join. They just don't get it.
They're discriminating. I'm clear about it. So I think I'm going to argue with that red spot until it gets it. It's not going to happen.
Until it becomes the black spot?
And until it merges with that white or black or any color. And I think I'll dedicate my life to that.
Okay.
Hopeless.
It's hopeless.
What is, is.
It just, even if you know it is, it still feels like crap, you know?
Well, it has to feel like crap. You haven't investigated.
Okay.
How does it feel when you think we're not supposed to be prejudiced and we are?
Oh, it feels annoying. It's like it makes you mad.
Yes.
And it's frustrating, and it just seems so stupid.
So can you see a reason to drop the story? I'm hearing frustration.
Yeah.
Sadness.
Yes, I can see a reason to drop that
can
story.
You see a reason to keep it that is not prejudice or stressful?
No. I'm sorry.
Well, that's where I went with it.
No, I know.
You know what we used to stomp and yell for becomes just love. Who would you be without your story?
Love.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, you would be what we don't have the awareness of yet. We would finally have a teacher without prejudice.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh. Huh. And I just flashed on the weirdest thing. I just thought you could be prejudiced against pasta eaters.
Yeah.
It's just,
yeah, well, we are.
Yeah.
I mean, look at them. They'd be much healthier if they didn't eat it.
Pasta.
Or that person needs pasta. That person doesn't.
I know.
We are.
Our, you know,
we're
purple
prejudiced.
Crayons against green crayons.
Yeah.
Right, Jonah? You don't like green crayons. Okay.
So, people are not. I want people to stop being prejudiced. Turn it around.
I want me to stop being prejudiced.
That will work.
That's doable.
Well, you thought it was for us.
Yeah.
You had everything that we could do it.
It's funny.
If we just listen to you.
And I just didn't realize how unloving that was to not let people have the prejudice.
Yeah. I mean,
amazing.
Like you had a choice.
Yeah, right. True.
Ah, honey. This is good work. The next one?
Okay. So how do I want them to change? I want our differences to be acceptable.
And we don't want to. We hate when that happens.
I want it to be. I want my way.
Well, we don't want to. And how does it feel when you attach to that story and we don't go there?
Well, it feels annoying.
Okay.
And
can you see a reason to drop the story?
Mousy, one second. Can I see a reason to drop? Yeah.
Yeah, I don't like being annoyed either. I don't have time for the pain.
Or the lack of energy. Though.
Or the lack of energy.
Yeah. Okay.
So, can you see one good reason to keep the story?
Well, yeah.
That is not stressful.
Or, yeah, no. No.
Or annoying.
No. Or tiring.
You're tiring. So who would you be without the story?
Well, I would be more unified.
Yes.
I would be more together.
Yes. Yeah.
And less confused.
You would be what you wanted for us.
Yeah. I wouldn't, yeah.
So turn it around.
I need my differences to be acceptable.
To me.
To me. I need my difference to be acceptable to me.
Yeah. Anyway, you're an observer. Say, that one's prejudice. That one's not. That one eats pasta. That red mark is there, and that white one, black one.
That person wears a white sheet. That person doesn't.
Yeah. an observer of reality, a lover of what is.
Yeah.
Without attaching all of this meaning to it. I am woman sitting in chair with friend.
Yeah.
That's it. I'm just reporting the facts here.
That is so hard.
Is that true?
No.
There's only one thing harder, the way you've been doing it. So tiring.
Yeah.
And has it ever worked?
No.
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 But then... But then, well, I just was thinking about the guy in Jasper, Texas, and I was thinking about that these guys dragged him behind the truck, and then I was thinking that, well, what was the whole basis of Martin Luther King's, you know, thing, and then here we are, 1999.
How did I drag my three children behind the truck their
okay.
whole life? Let it begin with me.
All right, and how did I drag myself behind the truck?
You bet.
Oh.
I begin there. Then I'll go talk to those guys.
Oh, God.
That's how I'm able to go into prisons. Just having a good time. And Martin Luther King, he wasn't speaking to... Look at what he talked about. All of us.
Yeah.
That guy had it going.
Yeah.
It wasn't about anything, but... what we were born with. He just was clear enough to point that out to all of us. That's inside of us. You may be finding the freedom that he had. He was not a warrior.
Yeah, but he died by a gun. I mean, well, it seems to me like he was shot down like a warrior.
What did that have to do with him?
I don't know, but isn't it sort of the thing of we experience what we are?
Sweetheart, how are you going to die?
I don't know.
You know, maybe in your home, on your bed, but dying is dying. Let's tell the story she died in bed. Well, that's a happy story. Let's tell the story died by gun. Well, that's a terrible. We die. No one makes it.
Yeah.
You know, we tell a story about how it happened and we get to heaven or hell us.
I know. Okay, yeah. Okay. Ooh, I just enjoy this feeling.
Yeah, the righteous cause.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, who would you... What I found is I can go all over the world without a cause.
Yeah.
My cause is someone invited me here. That's it. And what happens is a really good thing. But I don't have a cause. I come open.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that more like you? Isn't that what you wanted us to live?
Yeah.
Okay, so turn it around and you live it. So let's look at the next one.
I just want to say that my image of myself is this. But as I wrote this down, I mean, I have an image that I'm very open and really not prejudiced. You know, of course...
Well, so much for that.
Yeah. And I think that this was the reason why my boyfriend got really nervous for me, because he saw that I would see something that is the opposite of what I believe is my image. So I sit here...
And you would change.
And excuse me?
And you would change.
And I would change.
Yeah, and then...
And then what?
We don't know who you are, and we become frightened.
Right. Just be still, baby, okay? Just let me just do this, okay? Don't worry,
but
I'm
what
okay.
really happens is you change, and... A deeper love takes place in my experience.
Right.
I know with a lot of ways, people radically change and people separate and go away. And it seems that in the work, people change and they do the work and get closer.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it's an opposite thing.
Yeah, I'm not afraid.
Yeah. And the next, and the next. You know, who do I write on next? Well, he's up.
Mm-hmm.
Or this, or this, or that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, what is it that they should or shouldn't be or think and feel? okay, I'm really embarrassed. Humankind mm-hmm. should be gracious, accepting, understanding, compassionate, or non-interested. Mm-hmm. Racism should be a non-issue.
Mm-hmm.
Should I keep going?
Well, it's pretty hopeless so far.
Well, actually, as I was writing Humankind, I was like, you know what to do, but I just had to go with it. I felt like I had to commit.
You know, people say, Katie, could you still write? Well, yeah, I could write reams of paper.
Oh, yeah, I know.
It's just, you know, there's... Not
just
a
that
lot
you get
of
to three and
to
you
it.
Already know what's up.
That's it.
You're like, oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it becomes more fun and more fun because we're observing. There's nothing more fun than me observing my prejudice because I can change that.
Mm-hmm.
I investigate it and really it changes. I don't change it. It changes. This is waking us up. This is realizing for ourselves. It's self-realization. So... Sweetheart, read the first one again.
Okay. The first of the three. Humankind should be gracious, accepting,
So we should be gracious, accepting, and understanding.
And compassionate.
What's the reality of it? Are we?
Yes and no.
Exactly so. Sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah.
So what do you get inside of you when you attach to that and we are not gracious?
Oh, I get pain, hopelessness.
Can you see a reason to drop the story? And I'm not asking you to drop it. This has been the story from all of every religion. You should be gracious. You should be compassionate. Well, I never could.
And I never am. If I don't want to be, I can be really awful.
And we can smile while we're doing it. Especially when someone's not gracious and compassionate, I lose my grace.
And you want to kill them.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, can you see a reason to keep this fairy tale,
No. This
childhood story from ancient beliefs?
No.
Who would you be without this story, Radon Angel?
I would be compassionate and understanding and gracious and accepting.
Yeah.
Oh.
So everything we've been teaching was only for us to hear.
Yeah.
Everything, all these incredible gifts you've been giving to us are for you to live. And it's so sweet because you remain the teacher, this beautiful teacher. You remain it, but you're the listener of it. So it ceases to matter if anyone changes or hears you.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause you're lit. You're the walking wisdom and clarity.
Okay, yes.
Let's look at the next one.
Gracious.
You know, it's almost as though I'm not going to be gracious about this until you're gracious. And then I'll graciously
be gracious.
Uh-huh. Okay, I'll graciously be gracious.
Okay, so do you want to see number four?
I do.
Okay. I need for the establishment to give up the need to separate by race, to not so instantly tighten up when a person of color enters the room, to just accept that a person of color can be smart, successful, brilliant.
Well, we just don't accept that.
And it was earned.
We just don't accept it.
Oh.
We're supposed to accept it. Can you really know that that is for your highest path or ours? Can you know more than God?
Can you say that again just the way you said it? I don't accept it.
I don't know. I'll give it a shot. Can you really know that that is best for your path or ours? Can you know more than God?
No. No.
How do you treat us when you attach to that?
I look for the things I just listed. I look for it when I attach to needing it. I look for it.
Yep. And how does that feel to walk into a room looking for it?
Well, it sort of justifies my feeling separate.
Yep. So you separate us.
Mm-hmm.
You walk a room, you look for it. You interpret it. You find
walk
it.
Walk into the elevator and
that's it.
I clutch my purse around that.
That's it.
Right, yeah.
So can you see a reason to drop the story? That we're supposed to... This? That we're supposed to see you as intelligent, or... What were your words?
Excuse me. Intelligent, successful, brilliant.
Can you see a reason to drop the
not
story?
Not race first.
Can you see a reason to drop the story that we're supposed to see that first? That you're intelligent, you're beautiful. We're supposed to, can you drop the story? We're supposed to see that first? That you're loving? Well, we're not going to. I can just tell you that.
Right.
Can you see a reason to drop the story?
I don't know. I'm having problems with that. It's funny. It's like there's this. I just have this like wedge of resistance.
Okay.
I can say yes, but it just would be bullshit.
Right on. And I can tell you that we are going to see what we see.
Yeah.
You can't control how we can. We control. Can anyone control what you see in the world?
Your turn. Can anyone control what I see in the world?
Mm-hmm. Can someone say Ray Dawn?
No, of course okay. not. Of course not.
Ray Dawn, I want you to see that woman over there as a male.
No.
Honey, you don't understand. I want you to see that. All I don't want you to see she's a woman first.
Okay, Katie, I get it.
Okay.
All right.
So can you control the way we see you?
No.
So how does it feel when you attempt to change the way we even see? You want to control our thinking. Hopeless.
I know.
I mean, you can't even control your own thinking, and you want to control ours.
I can't control my own thinking. If I could, I would be levitating.
So I do that. So. Don't even go there. So, sweetheart, how does it feel when you think that we're supposed to see your intelligence, your beauty,
and your
sweetness, and not your race first?
Well, it feels unloving.
Can you see a reason to drop this insane story?
Yes.
Can you see one good reason to keep it that is not hurtful to you?
No.
Who would you be without the story when you walked into a room?
Gorgeous.
Oh, honey. Truly, then you would see us the way we see you.
Yeah.
You would see you the way we see you, truly.
This is the end of side one. Please turn the tape over. There is no need to fast forward.
You know, Ray Dawn, when I walk into a room, I know everyone loves me.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone. I just don't expect everyone to have the awareness of that yet.
I think it's so interesting. I have my baby here just coming around screaming. Like, I love you. Okay.
I know, I'm great.
I have a baby just like, I love you right now.
Yeah.
Thank you, baby.
Yeah. You know, she hasn't noticed these things that way, you know. Okay,
no
Angel.
Idea.
So turn it around.
All right. I need to give up the need to separate by race.
Yes. When you step into a room, you need to give up the idea of race.
Okay. Kind of, that's intense.
Yeah.
You never think you carry that shingle, and you do. I mean, yeah, okay.
As long as I think someone's prejudiced, I'm prejudiced.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay. All right. Okay. I need for the steps to give up the need to separate by race and not to instantly tighten up when a person of color enters the room.
Wow. Any color.
Yeah.
And especially black, probably.
No, but yeah, maybe.
Yeah. because, you know, isn't that what this is about?
Yeah.
One of the things it's about?
Being, yeah,
look how they're
yourself.
Looking at him. I'll be the defender.
I know, it's so true.
Yeah, so there's your prejudice.
Like,
about
I'm
going
to go talk
person.
To him because he's the only black, other black person
right.
in the room.
I'll go take care of him.
Maybe that's the only reason you were nice to me.
No, Marielle. You're a talented camera woman.
She loved me.
It just so happened, Marielle, that that wasn't the case, but that's very funny.
Okay,
go ahead, make it.
So
fun
go inside and see if it was a part of it. Was it a little piece of it?
Maybe.
Yeah.
Well, just
honey, we're looking at prejudice here. We're doing what you wanted us.
Yeah.
You're doing what you wanted us to do all your life, or how many ever years it was.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
So, yeah. Yeah.
And is that a surprise to you, Marielle?
Not really.
No. Everybody knows.
Yeah.
We all know the same, equal. This transcends race. Mm. There are no new thoughts. There's no one more or less with more wisdom or less wisdom. We all have equal wisdom. Thoughts appear. There aren't any new ones. They're all recycled. Okay, Angel. They appear to you to be met with understanding. It's a privilege. Keep reversing it.
Okay. I need to give up. Oh, sorry. I made it kind of messy. When a person of color enters the room. So, reverse it again.
Or just, was that the end of it?
Yeah, pretty much. To accept a person of color can be successful. So I need to accept myself as smart, successful, brilliant, and it was earned.
You bet.
I never even thought of that.
Yeah. Okay, turn around and put every color there, just that last part.
Okay, and I need to accept everyone as smart, successful, brilliant, and it was earned.
Yes.
1 second. Oh, excuse me. You owe you. Y-O-U. Yes, sorry. You. I need to accept you as successful, brilliant, smart, and it was earned. Okay, God.
It's like, oh, goodness.
You. It's so funny, the package it comes in. I'm really crying here. It's so annoying, it's so great. That there's like so much joy, it hurts.
Yeah.
I'm hurting. Yeah. Joy.
Yeah. Yeah, it's you know, to be this lit, you know, it takes a lot of expansion because all you can do is be it.
Yeah. Okay.
Let's look at the next Lady of Light.
I just see my stomach as being like this rainbow. I feel like I just blushed a rainbow in my belly.
Yeah.
Okay, number five.
Yes, Angel.
So what do I think of them? Make a list. Racist people are scared, annoying, frustrating, uninformed, interesting, stupid, and narrow.
Turn it around.
I am scared, annoying, frustrating, unformed, uninformed, stupid, and narrow.
When I walk into a room looking for prejudiced people.
That's what I am.
Yeah. So that's why you think it's us doing it. It's
what?
A mirror image of your thinking.
Mm.
And we look around at the room and we don't see all the faces that are just doing it. We look and we find one. And then it's like a disease. It's contagious and the whole room looks that way. We just find one to project off onto and then it spreads, you know, within us, our perception.
Just a second. Right.
So we'll speak it out so we can hold on to this concept and keep this body identification. I. So we don't have to know that what we are, you know, all without separate. It's so beautiful knowing that
Oh my, all the colors, the vibrations, everything that make up the body of one is perfect. But this concept would keep us from that awareness. That's the purpose. It's the obstacle we use to block us from the awareness of I am that.
Right.
Yeah.
I just, you know, it's funny. I just went to the man in the, my homeless man, the naked homeless man story, and I was thinking about him because he was really dark. And I remember thinking that he was like, he was pretty much the blackest man I'd seen in a while. Like, he was very, very dark. And I remember also thinking that his skin, he reminded me of someone from Mali, and I kind of identified his lineage. So it was like both sides of it. It was like, you scare me. And then, you're so beautiful. I think I know where your tribe's from. It was a weird double thing.
Yeah. So that is the honest topic of conversation.
Mm-hmm.
That one is the integrity that would keep you from knowing or experiencing the prejudice of someone without clothes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, gosh, you know, you're black. My first thought was this. My second thought was that. And what do you think?
Yeah.
You know, I was at a car wash with my husband, and I wanted to walk. And there were some men that were really, there were a couple of Mexican men, a couple of black men, I can't remember, five or six. And they were, when someone come through the car wash, we had the motorhome over in a separate portion, but when cars would drive through, they would surround it and beat on the car and until the person rolled down the window a little and gave them money, and then they would drive away, like, you know, the story, afraid for their lives. And then these guys would high-five and spin and laugh. I thought, whoa, they are having a good time. So...
So not where I thought you were going to go with that.
So I thought, you know, I want to walk. That was my first thing, and I follow the voice. I want to walk. And then the thought, well, they'll focus on me if I walk that way. Can I really know that that's true?
Mm.
No. So I start walking, and they focus on me. And so that's what they came over, and they started this stuff. And I said, you know, I watch you, I hear you, you give each other the high five, you play, you spin, you're not including me, I want to play, I don't know how.
Oh my goodness.
So then when my husband came out to find me an hour or so later, we're all sitting on the curb with one in my lap. Oh, it was so good.
You had one in your lap.
Yeah, and one went across the street, got some good stuff, you know, brought it back, and it's not what I do, but they loved it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man.
So the great conversation is that you are like the one of the blackest people I've ever met.
Mm-hmm.
And I had the story this, and then I had the story that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know, so you don't have any clothes on. Mm-hmm. What's up? Give them, I want to know everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then what can happen is they say, you're beautiful, and I want you. And you say, I understand that, and I'm not there yet. I want to know about you.
Yeah.
And if they say, well, I want to... into you, you go, I understand it. And then you go do the manager or something, you know? But isn't that the truth? This joining thing is everything, Ray Dawn. And but you were looking at his color, you were looking at his nakedness, you were looking, you know, you're stalking.
Yeah.
Walking through the room,
yeah.
Getting control of what you can never have.
Well, you know, it's funny, last night I had dinner and I was the dinner partner to a family who are from South Africa, and they were a white family. Actually, there were seven people from South Africa, and they were, it was a 50th birthday party, and they'd all lived under apartheid.
Mm.
And the first man said that that the genocide in Africa was unimportant because there was nothing for America to gain. So the reason why they're in wherever they are now, coast Kosovo, is because it threatens Paris. Mm-hmm. And so millions of black people being killed is no problem. This is the man from South Africa in apartheid. And I, of course, was so shocked because I thought that that wasn't really fair that he would say that. And then, of course, I kind of lit into him because he was white South African. And I kind of asked him if he ever even knew about the experience of being black in South Africa, or could even, and he basically said he did actually understand being a prisoner and being South African, but not from a black perspective. But I found a lot of prejudice coming up for me against him.
Yeah, good work, honey. That's all it's about is your own self-realization. Because he is God disguised as this man, showing you your own prejudice to heal.
Yeah.
And nothing else is possible for me.
And then you want to know something else?
I do.
The man was dark. And so at another point in the dinner, he was dark. I said, you look like you're Indian, East Indian. And you know, he said, and I saw myself, which is why I'm going to bring this up. He said, I'm white. Under my clothes, I'm white. And I saw the part of me that does that. I'm white, I'm half white. When faced with that, somebody black or some black establishment coming up to me and wanting me to get down and ethnic and black, and I'm afraid of it because it means I might not get what I want.
Yeah.
And it hurt.
Yeah.
And that's why I wanted to write this.
Yes,
that was the source of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, that's what I do know about you.
Yeah.
Yeah. We do whatever it takes.
Yeah.
We go in. I met a friend that, I have a friend, and he goes in, and the way I describe it is he doesn't know that that's going to be oxygen there when he goes that deep. Like,
I always think it's going to be like moss.
Yeah. And he goes in anyway, and he says it's amazing. There's always oxygen there. But here's peace.
Okay.
You jump out of an airplane,
thank you.
And you pull the chute, and it doesn't open. Well, that's terror. You know you have another chance, so you pull it. And that doesn't open. Then the terror ceases because you've lost choice. Then you just enjoy the trip down.
Yeah.
So, as long as you think there's a choice, or not. But as long as you think there's a choice, there's a lot of terror there. So, for me, you know, to be a lover of what is, and to do this work and just come to understand myself, that's the best shot I've got. Yeah, and it seems to work. Let's look at the next one.
Okay. What is it that you don't ever want to experience? I don't want to hold up the separations because of race. I don't want to hold up separation because of race. To uphold the need to be... to be the enemy.
Okay. So let's do the first part of that. I'm willing.
Oh.
It may happen again. You may walk into a room and...
Oh, for sure it's going to happen.
And experience your prejudice.
Oh, my God. I'm willing to hold up the separation because of race. I look forward to holding up the separations because of race.
Yes, because that hurts. There's nothing more painful than that.
Yeah.
And truly, that's why you wanted us to stop without even knowing it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your love.
Yes.
But you could experience that within yourself, and if it hurts, then that's the signal to do the work again until you can see everyone as the beloved, is what I like to say, Ray Dawn, as your friend, as God.
Okay.
Your work's not done until that's done. So
even the grand wizards of the KKK.
Yes, Angel.
Oh.
Yes.
Richard Pierce from the Turner Diaries.
Yes, sweetheart.
Oh my God.
Yeah. That's, I mean,
oh my God.
Yeah, there it is.
Oh my God. Okay.
Ah. Yeah. So
all right.
Think of those men. I want.
You mean those men of the KKK?
Yep.
And Richard Pierce?
Yep, they should.
I see. They should. They should be who they are.
And they are.
And they are who they are, yeah.
So they shouldn't. What's really petty, they shouldn't.
Right. And I look forward to them being who they are and holding up the separation because of race.
We could say they shouldn't kill. I shouldn't kill. They shouldn't torture.
I shouldn't torture.
They shouldn't burn crosses on lawns. I shouldn't burn crosses. I shouldn't want one on their lawn. I shouldn't burn them in my heart. They're doing an action, what you're doing inside of you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the pain of prejudice.
Mm-hmm.
That's the pain of ignorance and the lack of my own understanding. And good that it would hurt. And I would get back to this so that I can undo my wonderful self.
And maybe even change them, actually, because you're so kind to them.
Honey, they have to change when you change. I mean, they're already changing. Mm-hmm. I hear you saying they should do what they do. It's a beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully, you know, you'll experience some kind of projection again of something that is not all right in the world where you know more than God and come to see that you're not the doer.
It's funny because you think, oh, I don't know more than God, but I guess that's what it's saying when you say anything. Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's why it hurts. There's the perfect recipe going here.
Mm-hmm.
Gosh, you know. Okay, let's get some feedback, honey.
Okay.
Nice, deep work. Yes, sweetheart.
It's Mexican.
I know, honey. The guy's a Mexican.
It's very interesting because I'm going to take it in a little different direction. You're mixed, right? Half white?
Yeah.
So am I. And what I noticed, a process that I have seen happen to me and to a lot of my friends who are mixed, is that it's kind of the reverse. A lot of times, it seems like we tend to focus, because I went through this period with myself as well. I focused on the ethnicity so that, and I wasn't even conscious when it happened, but I would focus on the ethnicity part, trying to disown the white part, so that I could enhance my victimability. Because it's a very powerful identity.
What was that last part? I'm sorry. So that you could enhance what part of you?
The victimness, you know, because...
So you emphasize... I'm sorry, I didn't hear the second part. You emphasize what part of you... could you say that again?
The non-white part. I would do that.
What part is that?
The
what part is that?
The I don't know if I'm explaining myself.
The Mexican part?
Yeah. The non-white part, yeah.
The non-white part.
So, sweetheart, you may want
to
take a look. It's a beginning.
I gotta watch myself too.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm with you. I know exactly where you are.
Yeah.
So, let's hold just a moment. Any other feedback for Ray Dawn? What you experienced here through her piece?
Yeah.
Would you pass the... Okay, stand up, honey, so they can see.
Where are you?
Hey, Roxanne.
Hey,
good.
I named my son Race, and one of the definitions is exact course. Mm-hmm. So I played with this thing. You said, they shouldn't separate... And I heard inside of me, it said, by their exact course.
Oh.
It was a really sweet piece.
Oh.
Instead of race, it was exact course.
Oh. And we need
an
exact course like we need race.
Absolutely.
Mm. Nice.
Thank you, sweetheart.
Thank you.
Jonna. Could you go sit there, please?
Okay, sit by me.
It was a great piece. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
I always have thought of myself as a social activist, and I've done a lot of work. I used to do world work seminars around racism and sexism, homophobism. And it's still hard. This is still a place. I don't know if you remember, Katie, a year and a half ago, I got into a thing about the police and being beaten, and if I was of color and you had me do this inner thing. But it's still a place where I get caught a lot. And but I have really done all that work, and Katie's work, I've really come to see. I'm prejudiced not only in my fears sometimes, and my own stereotypes that live inside of me, but also I'm prejudiced against white people that are prejudiced. I cut them out. You know, the same thing. I close off. I have a lot of rage and anger around it. And it's painful. And I noticed in this piece, as you were doing it, that it was less. Just noticed that it was less, and that was really something.
So I can come work with you. When I have those moments, I can come and look for you.
It would be great. It would be great.
Thank
and
you.
I just thank you for this, because I think your work is my work, and it's
this work is
work.
Everyone's work.
It's a collective thing, yeah. And when one of us frees it, it loosens that whole grid that holds it in place.
Exactly.
So for that, I just bow to you. Thank you.
In the back of the room there, sweetheart, stand up. Yes.
I just wanted to say that I did connect with what you said. And I really had to look and see that that's me. And I've been doing it. And I'm not ethnic, whatever, maybe I am. But sure I have identified with it inside.
Yeah.
And I wanted to say something to Byron Katie, that in the past two seminars I've been to, I've discovered something that's true about myself that I haven't looked at. Nobody ever told me what a good mind I have. I can see that I have a very good mind. And I can let go, well, I can trust myself. And I can realize now that I always could trust myself. And I just wanted to thank you for helping me to see that.
So welcome, Angel. So welcome. Yes, we all have good minds. We just all haven't met it with understanding yet.
I can see that.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Because now I've met it with understanding. Yeah. Myself.
I love doing this work with schizophrenics. You know, it's just, it's like if you work with 10 people in a day, what's the difference working with one person with 10 personalities? It's you're working with, and one of them gets it, and the virus spreads through the rest. And they'll ask you, you say, is it true? Well, ask 10 of them. You see, If I'm such a hard case, I have to do it that way, I'll just stay right there with 20, 30, 100, 500, you know? So good, Angel. There are no bad minds. There's no one more insane than anyone else. It's just that if someone gets too far out there, we get real uncomfortable. So we put them away or we medicate them or something because we haven't known what else to do. Okay, so through you, we get some clarity. And thank you for that.
Thank you.
Yes, Angel.
I want to ask you, can you really know that you are black? What? Why do you say you're black? Or to put it to me, I'm from Holland. Or let's put it a little bit other, in a different. You say the black experience. I can say the Dutch experience, the experience to be a man. But can I know what it is to be a man? You know, I know my own experience, but does it reflect the experience of other men or other persons that I call men?
So that's a really nice question.
Yeah.
You're black, you're white. Can you really know that that's true? What if no one had ever told you that?
Katie, when I have found that when I go to that place of just being, that there isn't that I'm Canadian.
It's a colorless place.
Or a female.
It's a genderless place. Over here, yes, sweetheart.
I have to thank you for this exercise. Mm. For the last several years, I've been playing the part of a homeless woman.
Mm.
And I didn't, I thought it was to teach other people.
Ah.
And what I got from your exchange is that it's to teach me.
Yes, Angel.
About my arrogance, about my own prejudice, about how blind I've been. I've interviewed so many homeless people, and two of them just keep popping into my mind. One of them was a young white woman who I kept seeing at Starbucks every morning, and I decided that I'd go over to her one morning and ask if I could buy her a cup of coffee. I introduced myself, and she said, I don't want to be rude, but I don't like black people very much. And she said, my sister used to be like you. She was always going up to people and trying to start a conversation. And we told her, why don't you go and be around black people? We don't like it that you do that. And she did. And look at me. My whole family has suffered from that.
Yes, Angel.
That was such a gift to me. I mean, I knew that at the moment, that it was a gift for me to see what prejudice looked like.
Yeah. God. God.
Very, very, very powerful gift.
Yes, Angel.
There was another woman that it took me 3 days to interview. She was schizophrenic. She was black. And she told me she'd gotten that way because she worked for the NAACP during the 60s when I stayed in L.A. safely and called myself working down in Watts.
Mm.
She'd had the dogs turned on her and the fire hoses and she lost it. And she said the NAACP tried to get her to go and see a therapist. I'm telling you, it was hard for me to hear this story.
Yes.
It did not come out the way I'm telling it now.
Yes.
But what I got was, I looked down my nose at this woman in a minute.
Yeah.
She went so that I could now go into the South and into any restroom I wanted to, in any restaurant I wanted to. And I have nerve enough to be looking down my nose at her. I've been wondering why this homeless woman, her name Bertha Rockefeller, and she talked like this, and I don't stay in quite this street when I do it. But when I do in La Jolla, California, which I frequently does, I get to experience what it's like to be looked down on. And I know that when I stand here as I stand right now, it's not the same.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm the same person. The lesson I just got is that Bertha, my character, is not for you all. She's for me to learn. And do I appreciate the lessons I'm getting?
Mm.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Don't you love her? You know, the woman she was talking about when she did the bend over thing?
Yeah.
Did you fall in love?
Yeah.
That's what you separate yourself from, that gift. You attach to a story about what that is that would keep you separate from her.
Mm. Love.
You know, at the Center for the Work, I tell them, you know, when you're here, answer the phone. What I learned in that moment of clarity when the phone rang, it was God calling. When someone knocked on the door, it was God calling. And that's how I used to talk. Paul would say, Jesus Christ, who is that at 3 o'clock in the morning? It's God. So that's the principle, you know. How do I know I need this phone call? It's ringing. And that's what I hear from this woman. She's not blind. The blind can see. The deaf can hear. The dead can walk.
I just want to say also to Katie that in my image of myself, I think I'm open. It wasn't until last night at dinner with all these people from South Africa that I thought, I think I hate them in a way. Ooh, I'm not very open. And then I saw the resonance from the homeless man to Mr. Mexican that I thought, wow, I carry a lot.
Yeah.
Yes, you would have to, as long as you are trying to change our mind about prejudice, you haven't changed yours. So until you change yours, we're not going to change.
And that's doable, which is nice.
That is doable.
Yeah, I like
changing
that.
Us is not doable.
No.
But to change you, then we all come in. To change you is simply to investigate, and that it changes you. You don't change you.
Yeah.
Then we begin to come into you, all of it. The way it's lived is, as you get clear, the whole world moves into you and then back out again as a heat. The cosmic joke was, I used to thought I'd go in, I got quiet, it ended, it's over, and then there was you. The cosmic joke is, you turned out to be me. And so it's not done until it's done.
Oh my
God.
You're
my body. That's it. We're you.
Okay. Yeah.
So then it allows, because it only gives to itself out there what it gave to itself here. That's the reason I said yesterday, love thy neighbor as thyself. I always did. I hated me, I hated you. And that's how that works.
Right.
Love me, then I love you. But I cannot love you. You know, I need to just judge you. It's what I do best.
Mm.
I mean, I can do that. I've got 20/20 vision. You want to know where you're off? I see it. I know it. I'm clear. Okay. So then write it down. Ask four questions, turn it around. Then it begins to dissolve here. And then when I see you, it's dissolved there. The same, the body. Simple. Simple, simple. Judge your neighbor, write it down, ask four questions, turn it around or not.
I just realized something listening to this, that I was born in Mobile, Alabama in 1954. Need I say more? Lots of racists. All my life I thought that God dropped me off at the wrong place on the planet, because I never felt like I fit in. Because as a young child I had this wonderful, loving black woman named Janie Mae that took good care of me while my mother was at work. And she taught me truly unconditional love from her heart and soul. And I had a suspicion that something was wrong when my mother and I were leaving the cemetery. I was about 9 years old, and I saw this sign, and I said, Mom, what does Caucasian only mean? And she said, that means only white people can be buried in the cemetery. And at that moment I thought, you know, I really don't think God cares. What are these people doing here? What is going on? So I wound up in California. And one day I realized that I was prejudiced against prejudiced people, and until this day, I did not know how to go further with that, till this moment. And I'm being faced with going back to Mobile this summer for a whole month. I'm taking my 3-year-old and my 7-year-old, and I've been like trying to prepare myself for this, because, need I say, I have all of my relatives and my friends are Southern people who have their preferences. And so now I think I could really go back there and handle my prejudice in the face of it all.
You're willing to go back there.
Yeah,
you look forward to it.
I am. I'm looking forward to the prejudice of my family that I used to hold.
Yeah.
So those of you that want to play this out are welcome to. If you just turn to the person next to you and look into their eyes and don't move, and watch the stories that run through you. How you think, you know what they're thinking, all of these stories. Okay? So those of you, just turn to the person next to you and look into their eyes and watch your thoughts.
First time,
you are so beautiful.
Here, honey, right here.
Then just hold it. Don't laugh. Don't. Can I have mic here, Toe? Can I have a microphone here?
It is
on. Okay. So don't smile. Don't laugh. Don't make nice. Don't make sweet. None of it. Straight up. Look into the eyes. Look into the pupil. Look into all of it. Just look. Avoiding that for a lifetime. That's reserved for just your most intimate friend. Well, the one in front of you, that's the one. You know, knowing that there are no accidents in meeting, you know, that's where I can honestly say I ask my husband for a kiss, or a hug, he gives it to me because he knows I'll ask the person standing next to me over there. Equal. I tell the story of I was doing just non-stop place to place and doing red eyes and all of this, and thank you for the donation money that you have given it. The work moves if you say so. And it was moving me. I was sitting on one of these red eyes and I was very tired and a lot of hours, and I got on and there was a man sitting next to me, and I took his arm and his hand and I put it over on my lap and closed my eyes and went to sleep. And he obviously didn't hold the concept. We were supposed to be introduced first. I love the one I'm with. Who would you be without your story? You are so beautiful to me. But I put a story on you. I would keep me from that love that I experience if I don't. But to investigate is to watch the barrier dissipate and then the merging.
This is the end of tape 2. Please insert tape 3 to continue.